Machines are doing more than ever before. This is a picture of Amazon's Kiva robots, which automate picking and packing at their warehouses. And Amazon now has over 100,000 of these and other robots at work, alongside an almost equal number of human employees. And Amazon is continuing to introduce robots with new functionality. You don't see the robots when you order something from Amazon, but you don't have to look far to see examples of automation. Just about 100 meters that way up the hill, our university has introduced automated cashiers, which you're now used to seeing in McDonald's and Sainsbury's. And automation isn't just for manual and menial labor. Machines are working as doctors, lawyers, and scientists. This is a picture of IBM's AI system Watson, famously winning a game of Jeopardy in 2011. And Watson has been busy since then. Among other things, it assists with financial planning, creates new food recipes, and helps develop cancer treatment plans based on a patient's genetics. As a doctor, I find that last one particularly exciting because modern cancer treatment is increasingly being tailored to patient genetics. In many instances, this can result in more effective treatment with fewer side effects. The cost of whole genome sequencing, which is to say determining your entire DNA sequence, has dropped to around £750, down from around £2 billion from the first one sequenced in the year 2000. But even knowing your genome, it can be very difficult to predict which cancer treatments you need. For some cancers, it requires around 160 hours of collective work by a team of highly trained scientists. By contrast, IBM reports that Watson can do this in about 10 minutes, and a recent study by IBM claimed it outperformed the human practice. Not to be outdone by IBM, Google's AI DeepMind beat a master Go player in 2016, and then last year beat the world's champion. Many experts predicted this was going to take another decade, given how complex Go is. There are more possible board configurations in Go than there are atoms in the universe, so a computer can't just be programmed with an optimal number of Go moves. DeepMind use a general purpose algorithm to help interpret the game's patterns. And not content with Go, DeepMind is now working to outperform people at the popular game StarCraft II. So to my students who I occasionally see playing StarCraft in class, you are wasting your time. Of course, playing games is just a way for computers like Watson and DeepMind to train and market their capabilities. DeepMind, like Watson, is being applied to practical challenges. But while this is provocative, machines doing some things cheaper, better, or faster than people isn't anything new, nor is the idea this is going to lead to social and legal change. Those concerns date back to at least ancient Greece, and more relevantly to this country in the 18th and 19th centuries. Advances in technology even led to the creation of a social movement during the Industrial Revolution. Luddites were a group of English workers opposed to automation eliminating jobs and who periodically destroyed machinery, in response to which the government made machine breaking a capital offense. History has shown the Luddite concerns about automation were misplaced, at least in part. In the end, the machines resulted not just in vast gains in productivity, but in more jobs for everyone. And since then, new technologies have always resulted in overall job creation. The automobile, the computer, and agricultural machinery eliminated jobs, but also created new jobs. At the turn of the 20th century, 41% of the workforce was employed in agriculture, and now less than 2% of the workforce is in agriculture. But this hasn't translated to a 39% increase in unemployment. Even as agriculture-based employment and agriculture's relative contribution to the economy decreased, the productivity of farm workers skyrocketed and agriculture's absolute contribution to the economy increased. So history repeating itself might not be so bad. So why the concern now and why regulate at all? Let's start with tax law. And I know you were expecting this to be about sex robots or killer robots or killer sex robots, but we will get there. Automation concerns a lot more than technological unemployment, but it is one of the things most people are most concerned about, and for good reason. But for all the debates about machines putting people out of work, machines may be putting people out of work for a very surprising reason. Taxes. And that's because machines have a number of tax advantages over people. Automation allows businesses to avoid wage taxes levied by central and local taxing authorities. For example, employers generally have to pay 13.8% on top of someone's salary in the form of a national insurance contribution. But if a machine can replace a person, the employer saves that 13.8%. So if an automatic cashier in our uni costs the same amount as a human employee or even 10% more, the university may save money by automating on a post-tax basis. And that's just part of it. Employers can accelerate tax deductions for automated workers, but not human workers. And employers receive a variety of indirect tax incentives, some of which are fairly complex and I won't get into here. Our system wasn't designed to do this, but it was designed to primarily tax labor rather than capital. And this has the unintended effect of inefficiently incentivizing automation once the capital is the labor. What's even more concerning is that robots don't pay taxes, which sounds ridiculous, but it isn't when you realize that income tax, national insurance contributions, and VAT are the largest sources of revenue for the government, together accounting for almost 60% of tax revenue. By contrast, companies only provide around 10% of tax revenue. Robots don't pay income tax, they don't require national insurance contributions, and they don't purchase goods and services, so they aren't charged VAT. Robots are just not taxpayers, at least not to the same extent as human workers. And if all human workers were replaced by machines tomorrow, most of the tax base would immediately disappear. So when firms automate, the government loses revenue, potentially hundreds of billions of pounds in the aggregate. And when you stop to think about the things that government pays for, like NHS and defense, and most importantly, education, because that's how I get paid, you should realize this is a significant problem. And it's going to be a crisis if predictions of widespread technological unemployment play out. How should the law respond to something like this? Well, broadly speaking, we could reduce the tax benefits machines receive over people, or create offsetting benefits for people so they're competitive with machines. But even those measures wouldn't address the loss of revenue that automation is going to bring about. That's going to require a fundamental change in thinking about how we tax labor versus capital and employees versus companies. My colleague and I have proposed an automation tax and a corporate self-employment tax to level the playing field for puny humans and to allow continued government funding. And there are several ways this could be implemented, the details of which are a bit beyond today's talk, although there are certainly devils there. But with automation contributing its fair share to the economy, we could fund retraining programs for workers, enhance social benefits, and maybe even universal basic income, which would involve the government paying each citizen regardless of their employment. Widespread automation is going to force us to rethink how it is that we're going to allocate resources and redistribute wealth. But one thing is for sure, those killer sex robots are going to have to pay taxes. And automation's about a lot more than taxes. All these things that only a person used to do, machines are going to be doing soon, like chauffeuring LeBron James around. He's smiling in his self-driving car, but only until the car starts playing basketball. And driverless cars are already being tested in London, if you haven't seen them. The government wants to become a leader in autonomous tech, and it has invested hundreds of millions of pounds into driverless initiatives. The government says these cars will be allowed to drive freely on our streets in 2021. And if that happens, industry is going to be ready for it. BMW, Ford, and Hyundai all will have fully autonomous cars by then, and Renault-Nissan plans to sell theirs a year sooner in 2020. Uber is promising they'll have self-driving cars commercially available next year, using them, not testing them. They're already testing them in the United States. And if that's not good enough for you, Elon Musk promises Tesla will have a fully autonomous car this year. People have mixed feelings about that. In fact, surveys often show negative opinions and that people would feel unsafe with their car driving them around, never mind that people generally don't think twice about taxi drivers driving them around. But self-driving cars may already be safer than people because driving is dangerous, and nearly 2,000 people a year die in this country from car accidents. More than 1 million people die each year from car accidents, and tens of millions are non-fatally injured. And that's almost all to do with people being terrible drivers. 94% of car accidents are caused by human error, and a human driver causes a fatality once every 100 million miles. There have been two fatalities involving self-driving Teslas, one in the US and one in China, with millions, hundreds of millions of miles driven by the system, and these were fatalities for which regulators ultimately found Tesla wasn't at fault, although they do speak to the challenges of human-machine interaction. And then, just yesterday, there was a fatality involving a pedestrian and a self-driving Volvo operated by Uber. It's early to know what happened in that case. The U.S. Tesla investigation took a long time, but some politicians have already taken to damning self-driving technologies generally. And yet, even if the machine was entirely at fault, this would be the first fatality caused by a self-driving car. Whereas for the last year we have statistics on, 2016, 37,461 people were killed in car accidents in the United States. The perfect shouldn't be the enemy of the good, and self-driving cars don't need to be absolutely safe to make us safer. They just need to be safer than people, and that bar is low. I have no special insights into whether self-driving cars are already safer than people, but I do know these technologies are improving quickly, so it won't be long until autonomous vehicles are safer than people, and from there, substantially safer than people. And that's interesting for a number of reasons, particularly for those of us in torts. But in law, a tort is a wrongful civil act as opposed to a criminal act, other than under contract, where one person is harmed by another and it gives way to a right to sue. Tort law defines what constitutes a legal injury and when someone else may be held accountable, and for accidents caused by people, we generally require negligence for liability. Negligence means that not only did someone cause an injury, but that their actions fell below those of a reasonable person. To apply this test, courts have developed over the course of centuries a concept of a hypothetical, reasonable person who doesn't really exist, but who sets the standard for human behaviors. If a reasonable person wouldn't have been able to stop a car in time to prevent hitting a child running out into the street, a driver won't be liable. If a reasonable person would have stopped, a driver will be liable. This concept of a reasonable person isn't unique to torts. It's a concept that applies in many other areas, including criminal and contract law. But you hear about tort liability a lot when you hear about self-driving cars. If Uber was at fault in yesterday's accident, who's going to be liable for this? I think there's an answer that isn't a great mystery. We already have a legal regime revolving around injuries caused by products. Self-driving cars are products. So we could just apply product liability law to self-driving car accidents. And to oversimplify, we have a different regime for accidents caused by products than we do from accidents caused by people. The law holds manufacturers and retailers of products strictly liable for accidents caused when a machine is defective or its properties are misrepresented. Strict liability refers to the fact we base liability on causation without regard to whether there was socially blameworthy conduct. Strict liability is a lower bar for liability, and that's a good rule for most products. There's more liability for manufacturers, but it incentivizes them to make safer products, and they're really in the best position to improve product safety. But more liability for manufacturers doesn't always mean fewer accidents. Not if the product is safer than the existing standard. In that case, product liability law can actually make us less safe. When autonomous machines have more liability than people, that makes them costly to implement. And what we want to do is encourage automation through tort liability in situations where it would improve safety, or at least not discourage it. So I propose that instead of evaluating accidents caused by autonomous machines under strict liability, when they're safer than people, we should apply a negligence standard. In a sense, this would treat an autonomous machine like a person in tort law, and it would focus on the machine's act rather than its design. So rather than asking whether the machine has a design flaw, we'd ask whether the machine acted in such a way that if a reasonable person had done such a thing, it would have fallen below that standard, the same way we do with human defendants. And as with people, we don't ask whether someone thought what they were doing was reasonable or what they were thinking. We just ask whether the act they did seemed objectively reasonable. So here, as with tax law, people and machines will be competing at the same sorts of activities and exhibiting similar behaviors and responsibilities. But this time, the deck is stacked in favor of people. Holding autonomous machines to a negligence standard would help to level the playing field and incentivize the introduction of safer technologies. Not that autonomous machines would be personally liable for injuries. Machines are owned as property, they don't have money, and they wouldn't be influenced by the specter of liability the way a person might. So a manufacturer would still remain liable for accidents caused by their machines. They're still in the best position to improve safety and weigh the risks and benefits of new technologies. This would be a market-based mechanism that would encourage the introduction of safer technologies without government funding, additional regulatory burdens, or new administrative responsibilities. Underlying the need for a new liability regime is the difference between an ordinary machine and an autonomous machine, or between a blender and a self-driving car. It's a meaningful distinction, theoretically and functionally, that justifies a new standard of regulation. Ordinary machines are essentially tools. If you throw an axe at someone, the axe hasn't committed a battery, you have. And ordinary machines have gotten very sophisticated, so instead of throwing axes, you can remote control a drone to fire a missile on the other side of the earth, but there's still a person controlling what a machine does. The machine is just making a person more efficient. Autonomous machines are different. You give an autonomous machine a goal, and the machine determines for itself the means of achieving that goal. So you would tell a level 4 or 5 autonomous driving car to take you from Guildford to Loch Ness, but you don't control how it gets there. That difference is analogous to the way the law differentiates right now between independent contractors and employees. The difference focuses on the degree of control a firm has in controlling how the worker does their job. Autonomous machines, which I think of functionally as machines which control the means by which they achieve goals, are stepping into the shoes of people and performing the same activities, activities which used to be exclusively human. They're exercising the functional equivalent of human judgment, and often in a way not directly attributable to a human programmer. But applying a negligence framework to the accidents of autonomous vehicles is the less important part of the tort story. Here's where things, I think, get really interesting. Once self-driving cars are safer than people, it isn't going to be long until they're substantially safer than people, perhaps to the point where they may almost never cause accidents. And once that happens, it's really not going to matter what liability regime we apply to them. It'll matter what liability regime we apply to ourselves, because then the only danger on the road will be people. And when that happens, I propose that instead of holding human drivers to the reasonable person standard, which we've been doing for centuries, we ought to be holding human drivers to the standard of a self-driving car, a reasonable robot standard, so to speak. Or really a reasonable autonomous machine standard, but that doesn't have quite the same ring to it, and I'm still working on that. Once self-driving cars are exponentially safer than people, almost any accident someone causes is going to be negligent by comparison to a computer. So today, if a child jumps in front of your car while you're on your way at home at night on the A3, and you can't stop in time, you probably won't be liable. But if a self-driving Waymo car would have stopped, even if it's just because it uses LiDAR, then you would be liable. In contrast to the reaction of yesterday's events, it may be that every time a person causes a car accident in the future, politicians are going to say we need to take people off the road. My test wouldn't prohibit people from driving, although that could be done, but instead the standard would mean that people drive at their own risk and they're responsible for any harm that they cause. It internalizes the risk of driving. And I think that would be a better system, potentially, than banning human drivers, because it promotes human freedom and autonomy. At the same time, it provides a strong financial incentive for safer practices. Self-driving cars are just an example. Torts applies to nearly every area of human activity, like medicine. And last November, it was reported that this adorable-looking robot, Xiaoyi, took and passed by a wide margin China's National Medical Licensing Examination, which is the test someone takes to become a medical doctor in China. It knows the contents of dozens of medical textbooks, millions of medical records, and hundreds of thousands of articles, but to pass the test, it also had to learn, reason, and make judgments by itself. We have a critical GP shortage right now at NHS, so it won't surprise me if autonomous machines like Xiaoyi are soon filling that gap. Perhaps you'll see the robot first, or maybe you'll see the robot and the human doctor together, but that's not where it's going to stop. Sure, machines can only outcompete people in medicine right now at very narrow areas of practice, but the machines are getting better very quickly, and the human doctors aren't. So once something like Watson consistently outperforms human doctors, it's going to be downright dangerous to allow people to compete with machines. Soon, you may have the choice of seeing the robot or the human doctor, and I will probably opt for the robot. Because make no mistake, human doctors are downright dangerous. If you think a lot of people are dying from car accidents, medical error probably kills far more. And estimates vary on this, but the medical profession has widely acknowledged for 2 decades now that medical error is a leading cause of human death. So right up there with worrying about having a heart attack or a stroke or getting cancer, you need to worry about going to see the doctor. I mean, still keep seeing the doctor, though. It's better than not going to see the doctor, but when you go, just be anxious. Again, Shawi doesn't have to be perfect to improve safety. It just has to be a little bit better than human doctors, and that's a very low bar. And why shouldn't this robot come to outperform human doctors when it can access the entire wealth of medical literature with perfect recall, directly experience treating millions of patients, and be immune to fatigue? So even allowing people to compete with machines will be dangerous, and for human doctors who take an oath to first do no harm, unethical. So machines are going to be cheaper, better, and faster than us at many, most, or all tasks, which means that we're going to get to sit around being creative all day long, which is surely a uniquely human quality. But I'm afraid that even leaving aside elephant painting and monkey selfies, we hardly monopolize creativity. Machines have been autonomously generating creative works for at least half a century. And in addition to creative works like paintings, they're autonomously generating new scientific discoveries. That's interesting for those of us in intellectual property law, which is the branch of law concerning property rights in intangible creations, or what we sometimes call products of the mind. We provide legal protections for many types of intellectual property, copyright for books and music, patents for certain types of discoveries, but what happens when a machine creates a mental product? Well, sticking to inventions for the moment, the first patent I found for an invention by an AI system was in 1998, and it was done by a neural network-based computer named the Creativity Machine. The way it worked, the Creativity Machine was given a goal to complete, and from that it independently produced a result. It essentially consisted of a first node, which was networked on and off switches, that perturbed itself and generated novel output, and a second node evaluated that output for usefulness. The Creativity Machine, if a human being, would be an inventor in these circumstances. And in this particular case, the U.S. Patent Office granted a patent for that invention, but it did so in the name of the machine's owner, which was an easy decision for the Patent Office because it hadn't disclosed the machine's involvement. That may have been the first machine invention, but it certainly wasn't the last. Computers in the 2000s were inventing, including something called the Invention Machine, which used genetic programming, which is an entirely different way to structure AI. And Watson may be doing this now in drug discovery. Of course, autonomy exists on a spectrum and not just for self-driving cars. So right now there may be few machines independently inventing. Most machines are just used like simple tools. So if you use a calculator, even if you're really bad at math, that doesn't make the calculator an inventor on your patent. Just as it'd be fine to ask someone to use an abacus to help you do some calculations. And some machines are a lot more sophisticated than a calculator, but still not quite inventors. If I have a machine, or a PhD student for that matter, execute a research study which I've designed and the results are patentable, I'm probably the inventor for that. But if I just ask someone to solve a problem, and they do, that generally makes them an inventor and not me. So if I ask my PhD student to design a better battery for my iPhone and she does, she's the inventor. I'm not an inventor for asking her to solve a problem. And if you ask Siri to design a better battery and it does, that would make Siri an inventor, at least if Siri was a natural person. But Siri isn't human, and so it begs the question of whether a machine can be an inventor, whether a machine should be an inventor, and whether we can patent something that comes out of a machine like that at all. Well, this is important practically as well as theoretically, because machines are, in fact, practically inventing, and inventors have ownership rights in patents. And failure to list an inventor can make a patent invalid or unenforceable. But it turns out, despite this having gone on for decades, there's not a law about this, I think, anywhere, certainly not in Europe and North America. And that uncertainty is, I suspect, why you're not hearing more about this. In the absence of a law permitting or prohibiting patents for this, it isn't clear whether the machine or a person could be an inventor, or even that the machine's output could be patented. And that uncertainty is bad for business and innovation. It creates opportunity for gaming patent offices and for taking credit for the work of autonomous machines. And while no law explicitly prohibits this, there's a lot of language in judicial opinions and in statutes about mental acts and invention being something that individuals do, which might seem to exclude machines. There's more law on the copyright front, although still not much. The UK was one of the first nations to protect explicitly so-called computer-generated works in 1998, and it remains one of only a handful of countries that do so. In those instances, the author of the work is the producer who puts the machine in motion. In the US, there's a Copyright Office policy from 1984 that prohibits non-human authorship. Computer-generated works automatically fall into the public domain and cannot receive copyright protection. That makes it awfully tempting to claim credit for something a machine has done, and the machine is unlikely to complain. The Copyright Office cites the 1886 case of Burrough-Giles v. Cerrone in support of that policy. In that case, a photographer, Napoleon Cerrone, sued the Burrough-Giles Lithographic Company for copyright infringement of a famous picture of Oscar Wilde. The company alleged the photographer couldn't be an author because a photograph is just a mechanical reproduction of a natural phenomenon. But the court held that any form by which the ideas in the mind of the author are given visible expression is eligible for copyright protection. The case that thus explicitly dealt with whether the use of a machine would negate human authorship, implicitly with whether a camera could be considered an author, and the Copyright Office has interpreted this to mean that copyrights require ideas and mental products, which it thinks that machines lack. Also, it thinks monkeys lack this. I don't know if dicta from the Gilded Age should answer the question of whether DeepMind can be an author, but that's what's going on. And this policy was revisited recently after the monkey selfies. So these were a series of images taken of itself by a crested macaque named Naruto in Indonesia. A photographer, David Slater, left his camera out for the monkey, and he later attempted to assert a copyright in the photographs. The issue seemed to resolve itself when the copyright updated its human authorship requirement to explicitly mention that photographs by monkeys did not qualify. But analogizing to the patent context, it could be that the output of autonomously inventive machines is unprotectable. Other scholars have argued that machines don't need incentives, and this could chill future human innovation. I argue that not only should we protect computer-generated works, we should recognize computers as inventors. And the reasons for that have to do with the reasons we grant patents in the first place, which are monopoly rights that have significant social costs. We primarily grant patents as innovation incentives. That even shows up, as you see here, in the United States Constitution. The idea is that without financial incentives, we'll have underproduction of innovation, and patents provide that incentive by keeping people from copying an invention. The prospect of a patent is thus motivation to inventors to invent. In the case of autonomous machines, even though computers don't care about financial incentives, the people who are designing these computers do. And so allowing patents on the output of these machines would make the machines more valuable and incentivize the development of inventive machines. This would result in even more innovation, and it would reward effort upstream the stage of invention. Also, acknowledging machines as inventors would protect moral rights of inventors because it would prevent people from receiving undeserved acknowledgement. And even though it wouldn't be unfair to a machine to take credit for what a machine is doing, it would be unfair to other human inventors who are inventing without the use of inventive machines because it reduces their accomplishments. It would also reduce incentives to try and game the patent office. As with the self-driving cars, I'm not saying the machines would own their own patents. I'd say the machine's owner should own its patents. But what about the fact that we protect intellectual creations and mental products, and we think that people are exceptional like this? Is the Copyright Office correct that machines don't think? Well, functionally they do, and that's all that really matters. Some machines are designed loosely on the ways in which biological intelligence functions, like neural networks. Others, not so much. There's a lot of ways to design inventive machines using AI. Machine learning and neural networks are all the rage right now, but expert systems were all the rage not too long ago, and they're still the way a number of leading AI systems like Watson are structured. Not that Watson's just one piece of software. Here at Surrey, we have expertise in genetic programming, which is how the invention machine functions. Sometimes these machines follow fixed rules, so they're relatively predictable by programmers, but even that can break down when the machine is put in new contexts. And with popular architectures like deep learning, you cannot know why a machine's doing what it does, and it can be lacking in explainability. So it's not always possible to trace back what a machine is doing to a programmer or a group of programmers. And even where that will be possible, it will be difficult for courts. The U.S. Congress realized a functional approach to this problem was needed back in the 1950s. Back then, there used to be something called a flash of genius test. It required the inventive spark come to someone in a moment of clarity rather than as a result of methodical labor. The nature of this test was never entirely clear. It seemed to mainly involve judges subjectively reasoning about what an applicant might have been thinking. Eventually, people realized this was a terrible test, not only because it's very hard to figure out what someone was thinking, but also because it really doesn't matter if we're getting inventions from Einstein or a room full of monkeys. What we really care about is generating socially valuable innovation. So with computers, how a machine is designed and whether it's thinking in a philosophical sense really doesn't matter. Patentability should be based on the value of the machine's output rather than a clumsy anthropomorphism. And once more in the future, we're going to see a similar sort of phenomenon with inventive machines that we saw with self-driving cars. At the point where autonomous machines start to significantly outperform people, inventive machines will become the standard way that research is performed. So instead of Pfizer going to its chemist and asking if a drug that treats one immune condition can treat another, or Exxon going to its chemist and saying, can you design a better catalyst, both companies are just going to ask DeepMind. The same way you'd ask Alexa now, how do you boil an egg? In patent law, we have another one of these human standards that's a lot like the reasonable person. This is the person having ordinary skill in the art or just the skilled person. It's a hypothetical person who we choose to represent the average worker in a field and who serves as a benchmark for human behavior. The idea is that to receive a patent, you have to do something more than the average worker in a field would have done. So if your invention would be obvious to a skilled person, you can't get a patent on it. If it would be non-obvious or involves an inventive step, then you can. Well, autonomous machines are going to change this. Because skilled people reflect average workers, once average workers start using inventive machines, they're going to get a lot more sophisticated and knowledgeable. And once machines are doing all the conceptual work, then functionally, the skilled worker becomes the inventive machine for all intents and purposes. And that's going to change a lot. Because the inventive machines are going to be much more skilled and knowledgeable than skilled workers, this is going to raise the bar to getting a patent. It's going to be difficult for a person who is not augmented to receive a patent or to compete with inventive machines, and that bar will keep raising as computers continue to get more sophisticated. The Watson of 2025 is going to outperform the Watson of 2030, and with no clear limit to how sophisticated computers can get, it's going to start to become difficult to come up with anything non-obvious. That's going to mean the end of patents, at least as they are now. And that might be the right outcome, because once everyone's using inventive machines, we've gotten to a point where future innovation is self-sustaining, and you no longer need patents to generate new inventions. Taxes, torts, and intellectual property are a few of the areas in which I've had a chance to consider advances, how advances in technology are going to challenge existing legal frameworks. And what should you take away from all this? Well, autonomous machines promise to be highly disruptive, and if history is any guide, in unexpected ways. Maybe we're in for just another industrial revolution, but if that's so, maybe we haven't done such a great job in the past of responding to disruption. A proactive approach to our legal frameworks could help optimize automation's social benefits and help ensure those benefits don't go to the few at the expense of the many. It may also be that we're headed for disruption different in kind from that in the past. A medium-term future in which there are few tasks at which people are more efficient than machines, and a long-term one in which there isn't anything a machine can't do better. Either way, we need to be asking what our goals are for these new technologies, what we want our world to look like, and how the law can help make it so. We have not done that. Our laws were not designed to deal with autonomous machines, and we're not prepared to deal with machines stepping into the shoes of people. We're already regulating autonomous machines, just not intelligently. How can you optimally regulate something when the laws you apply were sometimes developed centuries ago for different purposes? And even recent initiatives may be misguided. The Kingdom of Saudi Arabia announced last year it was making robot Sophia a citizen. Not entirely clear whether they really meant that, but either way, clearly not thought through. Everything we know about the law, while it might not be wrong, has not been adapted to where we're going. And autonomous machines are going to lead to more profound changes than we've seen before. So the principles we've used to develop a legal system need to be, if not rethought, then at least retooled in respect of autonomous machines. And we're at the beginning of this process, but we need to start thinking about where we want to go before we're overtaken by events. As we try to work out how to use the law to harness the benefits of automation, there isn't likely to be a one-size-fits-all approach across every area of the law. But there are certain core values and principles that can help guide policymakers. And this concept of autonomy is central to thinking about the best way to legislate. Machines that are stepping into the shoes of people and functionally exercising judgment are exceptional and are going to require special legal treatment. And in deciding how to treat these machines, it will be the functionality that we should concern ourselves with. What legal rules will result in the greatest social benefit from these technologies? Because at the end of the day, if you see a car coming at you, you don't care if it's a Tesla with an unpredictable neural network, an Uber with good old-fashioned AI, or even a human driver, you just don't want to be run over. And in the medium term, as machines come to outperform people at exercising judgment and become the standard way we solve problems, they should replace us as the standards we use in the law. With respect to Protagoras, the original sophist, times are changing, and our legal standards need to change with them. And as we move from augmentation to automation, machine will become the measure of all things. At which point, the challenge becomes less, how do we regulate autonomous machines, and more, how do we regulate ourselves? Because measured against machine performance, we may not even want people in the loop. In honor of our guest, I thought I might end by invoking Kerr's postulate. The longer a discussion about technology continues, the more likely you are to get a Matrix reference. In the long term, I suspect the robot apocalypse won't be Skynet. It'll be an army of obedient, ultra-intelligent robots that provide us with practically unlimited resources, including maybe time. That's a vision going back to Aristotle, who imagined in his Politics that we could delegate all the undesirable roles in society to automatons, which doesn't sound so bad. In such a world, you could engage in continual education and self-improvement, although I suspect most people will just hang out in some version of augmented or virtual reality. And if you get bored with all the time in the universe, why not take a frolic into a pre-singularity world, which is surely what we're all doing right now in the Matrix. But no, I realize I shouldn't end with the Matrix. So then I thought I might end by mentioning that if you'd like to delve deeper into the details of any of what I've talked about tonight, what I've written on this subject is largely open access and online at the University of Surrey repository or Social Science Research Network. Or better yet, I have a book coming out, as you've heard about, The Reasonable Robot, Autonomous Machines and the Law, which I'm sure you'd enjoy. But then I thought that plugging my own book at this event would be in very poor taste, so I'm not going to do that. Instead, I'll end with my favorite excerpt from Harry Potter and the Portrait of What Looked Like a Large Pile of Ash. This is a Harry Potter fan fiction written by an AI named Botnik, or rather, a collaborative human-machine work, to be fair to our machine overlords. Not so handsome now, thought Harry as he dipped Hermione in hot sauce. As Niall Bohr remarked, prediction is difficult, especially about the future. And so before you lose spirit and give up on doing anything at all, like learning a new language, coming to class tomorrow, or writing that novel, remember you'll be competing with machines that can write books all by themselves, but those books are just terrible. For now, we still need more J.K. Rowlings. Thank you.
Such a great lecture. So my name is Ian Kerr, and I'm from Canada. And when I was asked to come and make a few remarks, I very quickly figured out that they looked around the world and they didn't say who's sort of cross-appointed in faculties of law and medicine and the like. They said, who's dumb enough to follow after Ryan Abbott? And I think I fit the bill in that respect. And I'm very, very pleased to be here, and it must be such a joy for your dad to be here in the front row, and for your daughter, Charlie, to be beside you. And if people at the cocktail reception should definitely check out Charlie's purse. I've seen it, and it's spectacular. And it may even involve robots. Okay, so I'm going to only speak for a couple of minutes, because this is Ryan's night, and I thought that it would be much more interesting if we had a discussion, hence the setup over there. But I thought I would just very quickly situate the discussion with just a few remarks, pulling from some of the things that Ryan has talked about. So much of what is so compelling about Ryan's view of things and his thesis throughout the lecture, in terms of this idea of more and more we're going to see robots stepping into the shoes of roles which were once exclusively performed by human beings, and all of the interesting social and legal implications that come from that, is largely premised, I think it's fair to say, on a set of assumptions that are depicted by this curve. Ryan had a beautiful version of this curve that plotted out a series of technologies. I think it's a Ray Kurzweil slide. And it depicts a sort of broader take on what many people in the audience will know as Moore's Law. And Moore was somebody who, in the late 60s and early 70s, actually in the 50s and 60s, I think, is when he was doing this, he was tracking the progress in the increasing power of the chip for computers. And what he started to notice was that their power would double. Originally, he thought every 1 to 1.5 years, and then he later had to adjust his curve a little bit. But the point of it is, you get this beautiful exponential curve. And the power of that is such that you see, here we are at the human condition. And I'm an expert in this because I'm a Canadian. And Canadians understand hockey stick curves. And we are at the knee in the hockey stick curve. And so what's before us is potentially very exciting, and as Ryan pointed out, very, very potentially disrupting. In fact, if Ryan had more time and was speaking more about Kurzweil, he would have probably showed a curve like this, which explains what Ray Kurzweil calls the law of accelerated returns. What Kurzweil's point in a slide like this is to tell us, hey, you know what? When we think about technology, and we start to try to predict what the future is like, we make a mistake. And the mistake isn't that we hype these things. The mistake is that we actually undersell these things because we're used to thinking about progress on a linear scale, not an exponential scale. And what this curve shows is that if you adjust that those predictions for taking into account the exponential nature, you'll see that, in fact, there is even more potential for growth and progress in technology. I think the important point to situate our discussion is, of course, that we stand here at the knee of the curve. And we are in the human condition. And we don't necessarily know whether that curve will follow its current trajectory or whether it will take on another trajectory, perhaps this trajectory. Perhaps it will have an exponential phase, but then go into a stationary phase and possibly even a death phase. This, by the way, is the life cycle of a bacterium in a petri dish. But the point is that as human beings, we just don't know. And I think it's fair to say, from a technology perspective, that we've in fact been pretty bad at making predictions. And I just want to show you a few from the technology space that I think are kind of interesting. I had to pull this one for the audience today. The Americans have need of telephones, but we do not. We have plenty of messenger boys. This was Sir William Preece, the chief engineer of the British Post Office in 1876. I'm thinking there's a few phones in the room today. But the British did not have a monopoly on making predictions of that sort. Here is IBM president Thomas Watson, who is the namesake of the computer system Watson that we heard about earlier this evening. He says, I think there'll be a world market for maybe 5 computers. And if you consider that those phones that we were just talking about are themselves computers much more powerful than anything he would have accomplished, you would see that at least in one sense, he was wrong. If the world goes the way of Watson, it may turn out that he was right, but I'll just leave you to ponder on that for a minute. Just as one more prediction to take a look at, this is Bill Gates. Bill Gates is reputed to have said 640K ought to be enough for anyone. Now, for the young folks in this room who don't even know what 640K refers to, which was basically the amount of processing power of some of those early computers that Ryan was playing on when he was an 8-year-old kid or whatever, what we know is it's 640 kilobytes of memory, which our phones just have blown that away in terms of what they're capable of. Now, some people say that Bill Gates himself says he never actually said that. And let's give him the benefit of the doubt that he didn't say that. I can say this. When I was in the room with him in 2004, he made a prediction in 2004, 2 years from now, the spam problem will be solved. So I think we have a long way to go in terms of prediction, and I just want to keep us situated here as we start to think about a discussion, and I'd like to invite Ryan back up to the stage, and let's have a little bit of a chat.